Hello and a very warm welcome back to the garden. I thought today I'd do a July tour. The garden is absolutely full and brimming. Gonna do a harvest along the way and just kind of show you all of the things that's growing, and it's just looking so lovely. I'm going to start off at the first bed that you see when you come through the garden gate and look on your left. This is one of my highlights of the year. It's caraway, and we've been harvesting a lot of the green caraway seeds, which have been such a beautiful flavour, and now they've dried basically. So I'm going to save as many of these seeds as possible, not only obviously to eat, but also to grow next year. It's a biennial, and it's been so productive, and it's amazing how many seeds you can get from around a square foot. Now, moving on to this bed here, this is gonna be next year's purple sprouting broccoli, intercropped with just a quick kind of cash crop of radish. Obviously, I love leeks. Anywhere that I can find some leeks, I've put in some leeks here. And then we've got there'll be a second flush on this sweet pea. So we've cut this all back. In August some point, it'll come back with a second flush of flowers. But this is really exciting. This down here is one of my favorite vegetables. I'm gonna find one to show you. It's called Celtis. So it's a stem lettuce, and you can eat all of the leaves, but then you're left, and you can see how much is growing there. You're then left with this stem that you can cook. You can kind of like cook it a bit like an asparagus or something, but it's such a beautiful vegetable. It is so productive. You can use the leaves as a lettuce alternative. Something fantastic that I highly recommend. And then just got a row of beans that we've put in, and I'm really pleased with how this golden beetroot is looking. There's actually a couple here which are at harvestable size. Just about, so you can see all of this food that's coming out from this area. So up here I've got a bunch of carrots that are growing. You can see, I mean, look at that, just got so many coming out. I got a funny forked one there, but there's just so much food at this time of year, which is so nice. And then I've got a bunch of beetroot growing here. Usually my standard is bolt hardy for like my main crop, but golden beetroot, I mean, it's just such a wonderful crop, and I try and grow as much of it as possible. In fact, I'll be sowing some more very soon to then transplant in a polytunnel to hopefully get some extra crops in. And I've got a bunch of abundance dwarf bean coming here. It's all starting to flower. And I've just fitted a little row of leeks at the end. I'm just gonna see what happens with those. So this beast of a brassica here is the Asturian tree cabbage, and it is so productive. You know, the leaves, look at that, the size. I mean, there are even bigger that are growing, and they get even bigger than that. But this is just such a lovely thing to chop up and stir fry with a bit of garlic. Absolutely delicious. In fact, I grow less normal cabbage because this just replaces it. I've got a bit of parsley at the bottom here just to add a bit of flavor, which is really nice. Got a bit of borage here. We've got a climbing bean. I've actually forgotten the variety, but that's looking so lovely. And then if I come around on this other side, I'm kind of being hidden here by, this is going to be chocolate sunflower, that the heads are just starting to form. And then on this side I've got a red flowering buckwheat, which is, it's honestly, it's so beautiful. It's such a beautiful plant with, it's more kind of a pink flowering, but it's something that, it looks lovely. I'll get a bit of a grain and I'm very happy with it. I'm a big fan of kohlrabi, and you can enjoy it in lots of different sizes. This is kind of the smallest where I will start harvesting it, a bit like the size of a golf ball, but it can get as big as you want. You can eat all of the leaves as well. It's just such a super duper looking vegetable that it's like it's come from outer space, and it's just something so nice to grate up and just add into literally anything that you want. It's so versatile, so beautiful. I've got a lot of this growing and on the way, so I'm looking forward to a lot of this, especially
next autumn.
So here I'm growing some telephone peas, and you can see just how tall they want to get. This is such a delicious variety, nice big peas and nice big productive pods. But sadly, not everything can be perfect in the garden. There's some signs of some powdery mildew at the bottom. So I'm just hoping that, you know, it's quite a common time of year to get powdery mildew on peas. So I'm just hoping that there's enough energy in this to finish the cropping and enjoy as many peas from this as possible. Then further down here, you know, nasturtiums, they are so beautiful that they add a bunch of colour all around the garden. You can also eat the leaves, eat the stems, you can eat the seeds. There's a bunch of things happening in this corner. Firstly, I'm growing mangelwurzel or mangel beet, inspired when I went to visit Stephanie Hafty, and she was growing a massive one and apparently says makes a good wine. So I've got a bunch here and it's really starting to develop. Got rocket flowers, that they're just such a delicious, delicate flower. So much flavour. And then just here, actually, my field beans that I've planted, which are just, they're just a bit of a broad bean alternative, kind of grown as a cover crop, but I think are really delicious because they're broad beans, but kind of half the size, and they create these much kind of smaller, cuter pods, and they're incredibly productive. So it's really nice to see these coming into harvest because it's out of the broad bean season now, but these are now going to replace that so I can continue to get and enjoy the same flavors. And then over here, it's our second slightly smaller onion patch. The onions are starting to flop over, which means it is time to start thinking about harvesting them. And look, it's just so amazing coming up to the garden whenever you need some food. And just at an arm's length, you can reach so much different food. I don't know where I can fit this now. One of my favourite crops of the garden right now, and it's the thing that I celebrate when it starts running to seed, which is easily done, is coriander and their stunning green coriander seeds. In fact, if you want to have a fresh taste of coriander all through winter, you can combine this, mash them up with a butter, and then roll it into a stick, wrap it in greaseproof paper, and then freeze it. And then you can just cut off as much butter as you need that's infused with coriander, and you can enjoy the stunning flavour right through winter. So along the length of most of this bed, I'm growing one of my favourite kind of standard pea varieties, and it is Kelvedon Wonder, and it's coming into kind of proper production right now. There's just so many peas here, and touch wood, I don't know if bamboo counts as wood, probably not, it's a grass, but this isn't actually showing any signs of powdery mildew, so hopefully I've got no worries about this. I'll be able to get a lovely harvest from this area. So just down here is, I'm growing a fennel variety called Rondo, and I'm just twisting it gently to pull it out, and look how beautiful that is. I'm really pleased that, well, only a couple of the fennel at the top bolted, but again, we had so much dry weather. So it's so nice to be able to enjoy fennel and not have it that gone to seed. This is one of the darkest corners of the garden. And also, I don't think the soil health of this bed is that healthy. So I'm experimenting with a little bit more of cover cropping here. And also just put in some extra lettuce because they grow pretty well in not so good quality soil. You can see that this coriander has run to seed, but it does mean I can get more green coriander seeds, more than I need. We've put some leeks in the back. This is where we actually had a row of foxglove to add a bunch of colour in I feel that this is a very overly green corner. But overall, I'm happy with this. We've got, just out of sight, we've got Vesper field beans that are just starting to come through. Apparently they're culinary field bean, and I'm really excited to compare the taste of those compared to the normal field beans that I harvested earlier. This is the kale bed. One mistake that I make year after year is just growing too much kale. There's only so much that I can take, and it is so productive. So I'm limiting the kale this year really to this half of a bed. Three different varieties. The main one that I really love is this Hungry Gap kale. Has a very different leaf, but I really enjoyed growing it in another part of the garden last year and early this spring. And it's just gonna be a nice green patch during winter. And then behind me I've got Abundance Climbing Bean and then Trail of Tears. They're looking great. I'm so pleased. The climbing beans were a bit late to the party this year, but they finally reached the top, which I'm very excited about. So here I need to build a little structure because I've got some outdoor cucumbers that are actually doing pretty well. I'm growing market more, which is a very common one to grow in the UK, especially outdoors. And then I've got a new crop that I've never grown before here. It's quinoa. And I'm amazed by how fast it grows. You just put in a plant and it just starts, every single time I look at it, it's got bigger and bigger and bigger. And then there's the main onion patch just over here. And again, just getting, you know, really nice harvest of onions. They've all flopped over, so I think I'll probably harvest all of these today. And then I'll put something else straight away because it is the end of July, so I can squeeze in some more crops still. If I can do that and get another harvest and some more food out of this space, I gotta go for it. But you'll just see very quickly if I just start grabbing these onions. It took me no time at all, and that's only a drop in the ocean for this whole area. So in this bed here, I've got a courgette plant with a lot of courgettes starting to form. And sometimes it's really nice just working with the smaller courgettes, and because there's a lot on the way and obviously more plants around, I'm gonna start harvesting these, and so I can enjoy some nice, probably grilled on a fire or on a barbecue, cut in half. So tasty, so simple, and very filling. So this bed is the asparagus bed. Now as the asparagus is over, just waiting for the calendula just to continue doing what it's doing with this beautiful hedge. Put some amaranth on the corner just to add a very different bit of colour. I thought the only colours around here will be green and orange, so adding that kind of red purple I think works really nicely. So this is a brassica seed bed where we've basically all of the important things we've transplanted. I will transplant some of the other crops in there. Got some more climbing beans, ochre around the side. The artichoke now, I'm just gonna let it flower, which will look really lovely. I'm really pleased with so far the results of the compost pathway. You can see I'm getting this beautiful material at the base. We're continuing to add more and more layers and flip them over, and the process of walking across is really working. So we've got a video all about that. But if you also want a really easy way of just seeing how it is, we've actually got a Project Leeks blog, the project that we're doing to help make growing food as affordable and accessible as possible. And there'll be a link to that blog about creating compost pathways so you too can implement this and start, you know, even in a small space, you don't have to sacrifice growing space for making compost. Instead, make it in your paths so you can grow more food. So this little corner up here, we have the leek seed bed. So we've been transplanting loads of leeks. This area up here, I'm very happy with. This is Llanover peas. So it's a Welsh pea variety. And the peas are absolutely massive. When they get to the right size, they're almost like a field bean size, which is something that we actually have growing here. And the thing that's so nice about this variety is that even when the peas are massive, unlike kind of more modern varieties, which start tasting really starchy and really not nice, these maintain their sweetness. And it's so nice to start enjoying these again. And also, something that I found very interesting is we let the celery flower. It's kind of flopped after the heavy rain. But I had no idea that celery flowers are so small and delicate and beautiful. This is a coffee grounds bed, which I actually spoke a little bit about in the previous video about a formula for growing food affordably. It's looking really good. We've kind of started to mix things up a bit, but the coffee grounds have performed, I think, really well in terms of how the peas have turned out. So that's really useful. We're also experimenting with, at our other site, the potential of using used coffee grounds as pathways, as a pathway mulch for market gardens. So we're just learning a bit more about that, and we'll share the findings soon on Project Leeks blog. Now, these are my Christmas potatoes. These are Sapa Muras, but I'm really excited. But even though I'm gonna let them die down, I think I'll just harvest a bucket to kind of see how they're doing. So my verdict is that, you know, I've got the number of potatoes that I need, but not the right size, and they are a main crop. The other thing that I also need to do is probably give them a little bit of a water, and then they're all going to swell up to be nice big size, and I'm going to keep them in the pots and harvest them from December onwards. I love this little section at the top here. There's a few different things happening. We've got some little coriander flowers. This dill, you can see a lot of dill around the garden. This is stunning. It's a stunning flower. And it's kind of growing in between this leek seed head. You can now see why I always go on about saving some leeks back as an ornamental. I've got a little bee that's kind of, it's a little Welsh black honeybee that's climbing around on the other side. But I just love the fact that the dill is growing through the leek flower. This area was quite an underutilized part of the garden, but we've now put in a bed. We've got, this is one of the black runner bean growing up here. It needs a bit of a prune, it's gone nuts. Got some sunflowers as well, a few different things growing around. This big squash plant here, this is a spaghetti squash, one of my favourite things. And then behind you can just make out the netting, that's where our red currants are. We had such a beautiful harvest of red currants this year, and I don't know, I just love them. Having that red currant hedge running all the way along at the back of the garden is one of my favourite little things, and it provides a little bit of protection for the rest of the plants. Here we are in the solar tunnel. This grapevine is going nuts, but the birds seem a bit desperate this year, and they've been going for the grapes with before they've even ripened. So we've just put up a few of the CDs to help scare them away. We'll probably net some of them, but it's such a nice feeling to have a grapevine in here. And then also we've got just everything from sweet corn that's intercropped with dwarf French beans. We've got cucumbers, tomatoes, nice hanging baskets. It's just such a lovely little green jungle to be in. But the polycrub is even more of a jungle right now. So the polycrub is well and truly a jungle, and I'm struggling to walk through, but I don't mind. Firstly, I want to draw your attention. I've got three tomatoes in here, which are self-sown, and they were just growing. I thought I'll just let them grow and see what happens. This here is a cherry tomato, and it's been incredibly productive. This is one plant, and there's just so many flowers and fruits forming. It's absolutely nuts, and it tastes absolutely delicious. And I don't know, it's just so good to actually be enjoying fresh tomatoes once again. I've also got some cucumber plants in here, so got some main cucumbers there, but then this is all where all the tomatoes are happening. And I'll show you this taller one behind me. That's also one that is self-sown, and it looks like there's quite a few tomatoes ready there. This is another tomato that I let grow that is self-sown. I counted there's about 80 fruits on here at the moment, and we've already been harvesting some of these beautiful red tomatoes, and I think all gardeners can appreciate just how exciting it is this time of year when the tomato season well and truly gets underway. Here's the third tomato that is self-sown. This is a little bit behind, but it's looking like it's going to be a nice, productive one. I've also got an amaranth that is just self-sown, and I'm growing a lot more corn this year. I absolutely love sweet corn, and because this here is a separate variety, so I'm growing Dakota Black and also Golden Bantam, I'm having to keep them separate because apparently if they cross-pollinate, it doesn't really taste very good, and I made the mistake of planting them a bit close, so we had to transplant them. And these just look so healthy, and I'm really hoping for a nice corn on the cob harvest this year. It's actually surprisingly hard to film a video in here because everything's just in the way of the camera. But just here I've started putting down a soaker hose system, snaking it a bit like a meandering river around these different tomato plants. This is a Gardena soaker hose. I used to use them before many years ago, and I haven't for a while, but now just because of the amount of tomatoes that we grow and the amount of time it can take to water, and also trying to maintain a constant soil moisture, this soaker hose coupled with mulching with grass clippings, I think, is really helping to benefit the health of these tomatoes. Here's a row of cucumbers that I started off from seed, and we're trying, I believe it's the Charles Dowding technique of actually trailing up two separate stems per plant, and they're looking nice and healthy, and there's a lot of flowers appearing, and hopefully from this space we're going to have a delicious, very productive wall brimming of cucumbers. So there you have it, an example of the type of harvest that you can get from a garden in July just by going around and picking what's ready. I do one of these garden tours every month and I've got a playlist right here so you can see how the garden changes every 4 weeks. And I'll see you again for another tour in August.